Hello friends, I'm Mike from S Channel. Today you're gonna get to understand Trickbot with me. So many of you have been asking me for a lesson about the new malware, so I'm glad that I finally got it ready for you. We have observed continued targeting through spear phishing campaigns using Trickbot malware in North America. It is a Trojan developed and operated by a sophisticated group of cybercrime actors. Trickbot, as a malware family, dates back to 2016. In recent months we have been observing something of an awakening or resurgence of widespread Trickbot campaigns. Trickbot started life as one of many specialized banking Trojans. However, over the years, it has become far more robust. In many ways, Trickbot parallels the evolution of contemporary threats via its modular and expandable architecture. Originally designed as a banking Trojan to steal financial data, Trickbot has evolved into highly modular, multi-stage malware that provides its operators a full suite of tools to conduct a myriad of illegal cyber activities. Trickbot is an advanced Trojan that malicious actors spread primarily by spear phishing. These campaigns using tailored emails that contain malicious attachments or links, which, if enabled, execute malware. We are informed of recent attacks that use phishing emails to steal sensitive information. The phishing emails contain links that redirect to a website hosted on a compromised server that prompts the victim to click on photo proof of their traffic violation. In clicking the photo, the victim downloads a malicious JavaScript file that, when opened, automatically communicates with the malicious actor's command and control server to download Trickbot to the victim's system. Trickbot is distributed in multiple ways. It is common to see it dropped in tandem with emoted and Ryuk ransomware infections. It uses person-in-the-browser attacks to steal information, such as login credentials. Additionally, some of Trickbot's modules spread the malware laterally across a network by using the server message block protocol. Trickbot operators have a toolset capable of gathering information that can be used to support targeting, to trying to manipulate, interrupt, or destroy systems and data. Furthermore, Trickbot is capable of data exfiltration, cryptomining, and host enumeration. For host enumeration, operators deliver Trickbot in modules containing a configuration file with specific tasks. At the time of infection, Trickbot will typically deposit configuration and supporting module data into app data roaming. Establish secure communications, DLS, with a C2 command and control server. Attempt to update and reconfigure relevant modules. Attempt lateral movement through worm and share modules. Worm, the module responsible for spreading a copy of itself, was replaced by a new module called Worm. This new module alters Trickbot's HTTP traffic, allowing it to run from memory after infecting a domain controller. This ensures that Trickbot doesn't leave any traces of infection on affected machines. When Trickbot starts, typically is able to receive instructions from the command and control server and to download modules, which are sent with the configuration file. The modules are delivered as dynamic link libraries, DLLs. After receiving the infected host system information, the initial Trickbot C2 sends an expiration time and a new IP address that will be used to download further modules. The C2 servers constantly change and the Trickbot infection is updated with this new information. Trickbot uses HTTP, GET and POST requests to download modules and report stolen information/credentials to the C2 server. I suggest following these recommendations. If you do not have a policy regarding suspicious emails, consider creating one and specify that all suspicious emails should be reported to the security or IT departments. Mark external emails with a banner denoting it is from an external source. Implement filters at the email gateway for emails with known mouse spam indicators, such as known malicious subject lines, and block suspicious IP addresses at the firewall. Disable unnecessary services on workstations and servers. Monitor web traffic. Restrict user access to suspicious or risky sites and enforce multi-factor authentication. Organizations should consider using application whitelisting technology on all assets to ensure that only authorized software executes and all unauthorized software is blocked from executing on assets. Organizations should also ensure that the application whitelisting software only allows authorized, digitally signed scripts to run on a system. Implement a centrally managed, up-to-date anti-malware solution. In addition to valuable preventive and corrective capabilities, detective controls provided by anti-malware software are beneficial in providing awareness of any threats which may become active within the environment. If not already being done, consider implementing an intrusion detection system, IDS, to detect C2 activity and other potentially malicious network activity. Disable internet access at the affected site to help minimize the extent of exfiltration of credentials associated with external, third-party resources. Also, consider temporarily taking the network offline to perform identification, prevent reinfections, and stop the spread of the malware. Okay, now that's enough for this lesson. If you have any questions, leave a message below and make sure that you subscribe to the S channel if you haven't already. Just click that red button down there. Then I can let you know when I have got a new lesson ready for you. That's it from me today. I will see you next video for another S channel lesson. Bye for now.